マリア先生とヘスター先生です。
Und zusammen sind sie
The Consort Counselors!
Today we will speak about alternative fingerings. Alternative fingerings already came up in a couple of previous episodes, so we thought let's dive a little bit deeper into this matter.
And maybe you are wondering, what are exactly alternative fingerings? So here is a definition for you. An alternative fingering is any combination of open and closed finger holes, which is not the standard one that we use for a certain pitch. So for example, this is my standard C with just 1, 2, 3 and the thumb, and this is an alternative C, in which I play with the thumb closed and then 1, 2, 4, 5, 6, 7. But Hester, why would we use alternative fingerings? They are so complicated.
There are many functions of alternative fingerings, and today we will focus on two of them, and these two will be connected to ensemble playing. The first reason to use an alternative fingering is when you want to change the color or the dynamics of the pitch that you are playing.
We can use an alternative fingering to play a softer version of a certain pitch. So, for example, this is my normal G. And the soft alternative for G can be, for example, 3 and 4. And why is that softer? Because actually, by using lower fingers, I'm creating a higher pitch, so I can blow a bit softer and compensate for that. Hear the difference? Without correction.
You can also take an alternative fingering to play a louder version of a certain pitch, like this. The normal G, as we saw, it goes like this, and when I add a couple of fingers, I make the pitch a bit lower, but then I can blow a little bit more to create the exact same pitch and to make it louder. Normal. Loud.
You can also use an alternative fingering more to change the color rather than the pitch. So if you, for example, have a fingering with a lot of open holes like the normal G, and you use an alternative that has a lot of closed holes like the one Hester is taking, everything closed except for the thumb, then you get a very different color. Different possibility to make it covered by using half of the thumb and then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, maybe a little bit of 7. If you want to know more about the wonderful world of alternative fingerings, then there are a few resources that may be useful also so that you can practice them.
Yes, firstly you can watch the tutorial by Sarah and Jeffrey and Team Recorder, and we put the link in the video description below.
Second of all, you can go to recorderfingerings.com and look into the piano and forte fingerings on the left side of the screen, and there you'll find a lot of ideas for soft and loud alternatives.
And thirdly, you can order the book The Modern Recorder Player by Walter von Hauer.
Or Il Flauto Dolce et Acerbo by Michael Vetter, which is a collection of fingerings only.
And the last tip is try to experiment by yourself, as you will remember much better the alternative fingerings that you actually found out yourself. Good luck!
But Hester, how can I look by myself for a soft alternative fingering for a certain pitch?
Maria, the way to do that is play half a tone higher than the pitch that you want, and then add a couple of fingers and check if we have the correct pitch. For example, if you play a D, the half step higher is E flat, add a couple of fingers. Ah, there we go.
Okay, can I try too?
Sure. that's nice. How do you create a alternative fingering that is louder than the original pitch?
Well, that is actually even easier than the soft one, because the only thing you need to do is take the original fingering. So for example, let's stick to the D, and then you add some fingers, preferably fingers that are a bit farther away. If you add the next one, you already play one tone lower. With the next one, it will be quite a bit lower, a bit less, a bit less, a bit less. So let's see. Exercises. With us today is Hidehiro Nakamura from Japan
and Paul Schauenburg from Germany. Welcome! The first exercise that we are going to do is the same exercise as we did in episode 5, namely giving a pitch, the same pitch, to one and another. We are going to start on a C, and the first player is going to play a normal fingering, and the second player is going to play an alternative fingering, and the third player is going to play a normal fingering again, the fourth player an alternative, and so on, and so on, and so on.
When doing this exercise, focus on keeping a very beautiful and stable sound, and also on comparing the pitch of all the players, and make sure that it's exactly the same. Everyone is in tune.
And how can you do that? You can use a tuning machine, of course, but even better is it to use your own ears and evaluate what you need to change and do the next round, make it better and better and better and better.
Now do the same exercise, but instead of normal fingering and soft alternative, we're going to do a normal fingering and a loud alternative, and a normal fingering and a loud alternative, and we keep going in the circle.
It's going to be much more interesting and fun, because we are going to pass on a C again in the circle, but the first player plays the loud alternative fingering, the second player the normal fingering, and the third player the soft alternative fingering, the fourth the loud alternative fingering again, and then we pass on the same procedure, so alternative loud, normal, alternative soft.
You can think of lots of different variations of the exercise we just did.
Yes, maybe you can add an extra alternative fingering to the round to make it even more complicated.
Or you can speed up the tempo.
Or you can change the pitch in every round. Let's do that!
Second reason to use alternative fingerings is that they can provide a better mix or a more subtle color for endings.
Often when you play early music, you will find endings with unisons and octaves, like this.
If you want to find the nicest possible mixture for the final chord, you can build it up as follows. First, take the bass with a beautiful warm sound. On top of that, tune the octave with a normal fingering, and then add a soft alternative for the unison G.
Let's now try to remember how this felt and how we played, and let's play it all together at once.
And now let's fit it all into the context and play the final bar and play into this beautiful octave and unison that we practiced.
comfortable with alternative fingerings, you can create amazing effects in an ensemble. And we are going to try this now with an exercise that we call the echo chord. We are going to play a C major chord first. Let's try that. Maria, can you please play a nice C for us? Paul, can you tune the fifth up on it? A G. And Hide, can you play the third, the E? Let's try to remember how that felt and let's try to immediately start and stop the chord together. Now we are going to hold the chord a little bit longer. And we are going to do it like this. We play the C major chord and then first Paul is going to change to an alternative for the fifth. If that's really nice, we are going to hear Hide with the alternative E. And then when that's really nice, we finally have Maria with an alternative of C. So that we create gradually a softer C major chord. We are going to alternate between normal C major and alternative C major. And let's try to really feel how it is to blow very generously in the C major chord, the normal one, and then as an echo, very mildly and calm, you change your airspeed for the alternative chord. Since we have spoken about alternative fingerings today, we want to show you a video in which they are used a lot.
And it's a live recording of Vivaldi's Concerto in G minor, also known as La Notte, performed by Sebastian Mach on the recorder with the ensemble Matthäus and Jean-Christophe Spinozzi.
And then look especially to the slow movements of this concerto. You will see a lot of alternative fingerings in practice. Can you count how many?
Yes, and also pay special attention because you will notice that alternative fingerings are very useful to play all kinds of mysterious trills.
Thank you, Hide, and thank you, Paul, for helping us out today.
Yeah, great. Thank you guys very, very much.
Don't forget to subscribe.
And if you have questions for Hester and Maria,
contact us here.
See you next time.